tiny in all that air. The Philip Larkin Society Podcast.
Hello and welcome to Tiny in All That Air, the Philip Larkin Society podcast. My name is Lynn Lockwood and I'm the Deputy Chair of the Philip Larkin Society. Philip Larkin was born in Coventry and was a pupil at King Henry VIII School between 1930 and 1940, where he wrote for and edited the school magazine and took up his first post as school librarian. Former pupil Fred Holland wrote a short play about Larkin, and for this podcast, staff and students of the school have made a wonderful dramatic recording of this play. The current school librarian Helen Cooper joins me and Phil Pullen to discuss the play, its themes, and what it tells us about the Larkin family.
The idea for doing a podcast came from Lynn to enable the school and the pupils at the school to have some sort of input for Larkin's centenary year. And when I'd been thinking about really trying to plan events for City of Culture Year, I had come across this play in the school archive written by a former pupil of the school, Fred Holland, who also came back to teach briefly at the school. And that, along with another play about the founding of the school, which doesn't feature in this podcast that we're talking about today. But I got quite excited about trying to dramatise the history of the school by using these two plays written by people associated with the school. And so obviously the Fred Holland one, being about the Larkin family, was the obvious one to choose for this podcast. And I thought that it was a way for pupils to get involved with celebrating Larkin as a former pupil of the school during his centenary without them having to demonstrate a vast amount of knowledge about Larkin, really. I mean, obviously, there's a sort of intellectual argument for encouraging a group of pupils to read Larkin's poetry and talk about and analyse that. But really, I was more, if you like, there was a dual purpose, and that was to sort of encourage pupils to understand more about the history of the school and to take pride in the history of the school and the fact that we do have this incredibly eminent old Coventrian, Philip Larkin. My other thinking about that is that Larkin is very easily dismissed these days in terms of, if I use the sort of the flag cancel culture. And there's no doubt, you know, I'm not trying to sort of whitewash Larkin and claim that there isn't anything of concern, particularly in his private correspondence. But I also think there's more to Larkin, and that there are aspects of his upbringing and also aspects of his own personality and makeup that actually make him potentially quite interesting for young people today. We slightly adapted the play. Adam Price, who plays the visitor in the play, is quite a talented young writer. And I did a first redraft, and Sheila Woolf, who also provides the introduction to the play by setting out the history, so Fred Holland's history with the school and the performance of the play 20 years ago. She and I did a first draft, and then Adam did a third draft, and we tried to emphasise aspects to do with Larkin's gender identity, really, and the fact that he wrote as quite a young man, only 3, 4, 5 years after leaving school, he wrote as Brunette Coleman. And that, you know, in the times that was happening, it was a very difficult thing for him to, or anybody to explore, and that was his way of doing it. And I thought that was quite interesting for today's generation, young people as well.
Is that part that you added then, the references to Brunette Coleman?
It is. I mean, it's, yes, it is. That's the part that was added. In some ways, I think it's, I mean, I'm not claiming any great literary sort of, you know, ability there. But I just thought that it was a way of really emphasizing for these young people, many of whom themselves question their gender identity during, you know, or have done during their time at the school. Mm. But I thought that it would be interesting to emphasize that for them and give them a hook, you know, to try and explore Larkin's upbringing with him.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's, it's Brunette Coleman just seems to come back time and time again. Mm. You know, for a long time, I think people hadn't heard of that kind of alter ego. I think for a long time was regarded as something a little bit odd and a bit of a kind of avenue of Larkin that didn't really say much about him. But I think you're right with our current kind of deep questioning of gender identity in this society. It's fascinating that Larkin actually has got something to bring to that and something that young people could actually.
My feeling is that the more you look at Larkin and his correspondence, particularly his correspondence with Jim Sutton, that he clearly was questioning his own sexuality and struggling with it, and that possibly adopting Brunette Coleman as this alter ego enabled him to explore some of that.
Yeah.
And the type of writing that he did as Brunette Coleman was quite bizarre, really. To today's audience, I think quite bizarre. And definitely waves, you know, big flags, I think, for today's generation in terms of what he was actually trying to communicate or grapple with.
It's also interesting that the play is set at a period where Larkin had obviously moved to Oxford and outside of context of his parents, the tight context of his parents in the home, and yet had come home at this point, was home in Coventry at that stage from Oxford. So he'd got that space outside of the family home, hadn't he, really, where some of those things around identity and that set of influences from both parents really were something he was working through, and maybe had the space to start looking outside of that in terms of things like identity, etc.
And it may have caused more conflict for him, because I think one of the things that the play expresses really well are the constrictions of Larkin's upbringing. And he will have been exposed to far more liberal influences away at university. And so he's back for his Easter holiday and having to once again conform to the family's expectations.
And again, something that any young person that's gone to university can relate to, where you come home at the Easter holidays and suddenly all your freedom's curtailed and you just go back into being the teenager again, you know, the child in the family. And also I quite like the sense of sort of the mystery of parents, like what parents do and what they get involved with, that as young people, even young adults, you don't always fully understand. And obviously with this being a fictional story, but even so, you know, you do wonder about what associations your parents have and where, you know, what they're interested in. And it can be quite hard to see them as people in their own right, and difficult sometimes, you know, and painful to sometimes see them as people. I really liked those themes. Do you think the students enjoyed doing the play then? Do you think, did they reflect on it? Did it help them understand Larkin more?
I think so. And another thing that I find really interesting about the play is what it, in a very, very brief way, it educates about an aspect of the history of the city of Coventry, which I have to say that really, until I started researching Larkin, I hadn't really appreciated. I hadn't really, even though I'm a former pupil of the school myself and, you know, was a pupil there in the 70s and 80s, I hadn't appreciated the devastation that Coventry suffered. And I think that it illustrates that well. And I think that that was interesting for the pupils. I think that from a purely technical point of view, it was interesting because although they've all done a lot of drama, they hadn't ever done a recorded drama for broadcast, as it were. And so that enabled them to develop and explore different skills. And I think that they, you know, they completely sort of took in their stride the aspects of Larkin's identity that I was hoping they would explore. I mean, I just don't think it was noteworthy to them. It's noteworthy to us because we're perhaps not as comfortable with those issues. And, you know, we're sort of playing catch up, if you like, with today's 17 and 18 year olds and older. But for them, yeah, it was perfectly normal thing to be talking about and exploring.
I thought it was interesting as well, though, in that sort of context, that the play picks up on some of the things that Larkin had developed an interest in, for example, in terms of jazz music and some of the musicians that, you know, he was very, very keen on, the black musicians in particular that he was listening to, and how that would be seen by a Nazi regime. You know, there's another, that was a kind of nice, clever little bit of addition, I thought, in that sense, that, you know, there are kind of tensions about where Larkin might be going as opposed to where his father might have taken him or might have influenced him in terms of that.
And the resentment between the sort of more working class police officer who had, you know, cut his teeth in Oxford dealing with drunken undergraduates, and the realities of war, and the fact that, I mean, really, these old chaps were hoping that Larkin was going to get sent off to war so that he'd learn a few lessons. Straightened out. Although the visitor is a fictional character, all the other characters in the play, of course, are real. I mean, it's a fictionalised account, obviously, but the chief constable is a real character. You know, other characters who are mentioned, like Mosley and Domville, they were real people, though not characters in play. And there are, I think it was in James Booth's biography that he talked about Larkin being seen walking around Coventry City Centre wearing, I can't remember, a red tie and a yellow
waistcoat. Oh, yeah, and a green jacket.
So I have to say, I was quite pleased to sort of slot that bit in, that, you know, before he left for Oxford, he was absolutely quite flamboyant.
I mean, I think that's very interesting that he had started to develop some of that, you know, the elements of identity, you could say teenage identity at that point, even before he'd left for Oxford, there was that trait in him that he was beginning to exploit a little bit.
Just coming back to presenting real life people in fictionalized settings, this I was watching, you know, the final couple of seasons of Peaky Blinders, and of course that has Oswald Mosley, and you know, Diana Mitford, and again that presentation of that a layer of society that we're very fascinated with, pre-war Germany, you know, and I've been doing research into Barbara Pym this year, and she went over to Germany in the 1930s, fell in love with an SS soldier, learnt German, and her first novel, Some Tame Gazelle, had a whole counterfiction about Nazis actually being defeated and being forced to exile to go and live in Africa. Very sort of strange kind of counter narrative that she'd invented. She was eventually persuaded to take that out of the book. Yeah. So when you read the book, there's no reference to any of that storyline anymore. But again, like Philip Larkin, someone very intelligent and, I don't know, just not the sort of person that you'd expect to be fascinated by this country. But people were, you know, young people and people of all ages, before they really knew what was happening out there, were very drawn to it.
That's not at all surprising in that context. I mean, there's a really good book, came out a couple of years ago by Julia Boyd, which is called Travellers in the Third Reich, which covers that whole period of travelling to Germany in different guises in the 1930s.
You mentioned that in your About Larkin article.
I did, because actually Sidney Larkin's visits to Germany are mentioned briefly in that book too, mainly actually in the context of all the holiday visits that people made to Germany, not in terms of the other visits he made, but just as a, you know, if you like, as a tourist. That in some respects, it was that you were able to turn a blind eye, not as much as people did, actually, in some senses, but the German government at the time did a pretty good job in presenting Germany in a positive light.
Well, it's the land of, you know, grand epic poetry and opera, and beautiful forests and scenery, and yeah, it was definitely sold as a very attractive destination, and people did love to visit, didn't they?
Yeah. I mean, I just quote something from her book, which I think sort of sums up this kind of, if you like, dilemma around it. She said, even in the late 1930s, it was still possible for a foreigner to spend weeks in Germany and experience nothing more unpleasant than a puncture. But then she goes on to say, there is, however, a difference between not seeing and not knowing. And I think that's the sort of ground where there's a lot of uncertainty and maybe denial about what was happening that you find in people's accounts.
One of the things that strikes me about Sidney Larkin is that my sort of not particularly well-informed impression is that it was the English upper classes who were particularly sympathetic towards Germany in those years, and that in a way Sydney as a sort of middle class city treasurer probably thought that he was doing what his masters would expect him to do, and it like there was a sense in which there was a real class aspect to the admiration for Germany. I don't know whether that's a reasonable view or not.
Well, I think probably you need to bear in mind also that Sydney was well known internationally as a city treasurer, as somebody involved with municipal finance. You know, he had a very strong reputation. He was known across the world, and we know that some of the things that he admired about Germany were, he said himself anyway, related to the way that Germany had managed its economy after the First World War and how successful that had been. And many people would have said the same things without shearing off almost the political context in which that was happening. At one level, and some of the visits he made to Germany, it's clear, were in that context, and he was invited over there. And I suspect that he didn't go on his own for some of those journeys. You know, there would have been other people from maybe Coventry or other local authorities which were part of that same international, set of conferences and meetings, etc. Mm. We don't know enough detail about those, to be honest, to be sure. That's the thing.
No. There's been a sort of narrative developed about Sidney Larkin over the years that perhaps wasn't entirely accurate, hasn't there, about the statue of Hitler and the regalia and things like that.
I think there's a lot of conjecture about Sydney, and it goes back actually probably more than anywhere to Andrew Motion's biography in 1993. Motion was the person who got closest to some of Larkin's contemporaries, really, I suppose, in terms of who he was able to interview. And obviously he knew Larkin himself whilst he was at Hull, but whether or not Larkin talked to him about Germany, I don't think it's clear from the biography. But he spoke to people like John Kenyon, who was a professor of history there, who knew Larkin well. And it was John Kenyon, I'm just looking back at the article, there's an article in About Larkin, very early days of About Larkin, I think it's about Larkin 6, when Kenyon raises that point. This anecdote he talks about, the Larkin statue, and that it it was on the mantelpiece and you pressed a button and the arm lifted up. Well, we all know that the actuality of the Larkin figure that at least exists in Hull History Centre is about 3 inches tall. It's not electronic, it doesn't have a button to press. It's basically one of the sort of toys, in a way, that you'd find during the war in both countries, of soldiers and so on, figures. What we don't know, of course, was there another one? We don't know.
I'm not sure that the size of the statue makes that much difference. I mean, it is, I have seen it in the 2017 exhibition at the Bryn Mawr Jones Library. It's actually quite a funny piece. I mean, I know Hitler himself, obviously, goes without saying, was not funny. But to have been brought up in a family where Germany was the chosen destination or the preferred destination for family holidays, and there is mention in in Sydney's travel diaries or Eva's postcards or whatever of walking down streets emblazoned with, swastikas and things like that. To also have a little statue of Hitler, of whatever size, that's quite an insight into what life was like in the late 1930s. I think it's interesting from Coventry's point of view. If you look at it from the point of view of Coventry's history, we've talked about the level of destruction in Coventry. The fact that the city treasurer, one of the most eminent or prominent city officials, did have this love affair with Germany of without judging what the nature of that love affair was. The fact is that Sydney was completely smitten with the country and was, had the foresight to order 1,000 cardboard coffins at the outset of war. Yeah. And, it's a very strange thing. Coventry's history, it amazes me to look at Coventry. And for example, another bit that was added into the play was the speech at one of the mass burials by the Bishop of Coventry, where he basically tells the gathered mourners that they've got to sort of suck it up and carry on because, that's their duty. And then when you come further to more modern days, when you look at what was done to the manufacturing industry in Coventry, Coventry's had a really tough time. And it hasn't, in my view, actually been treated very well by the ruling classes. And so the insight that you get into what has happened to Coventry from the point of view of there being, as I say, this city official who spent a lot of time in Nazi Germany before the war and then did a marvellous job earning himself an OBE because he dealt so fantastically with the city's finances during that time. Yeah. It's a very complicated history.
Yeah, very much so, yeah. And, I mean, the other thing that is reflected in the play, of course, is it's the basis of it, isn't it? It's the question of whether or not Sydney was involved in these sort of fascist organisations, Nazi sympathisers, the link being the one that I think the play is referring to, isn't it?
Yes.
There's no evidence that Larkin was involved, Sidney Larkin was involved with the link. Is something that I know that James Booth was looking into in the last biography. Although I suppose it's quite interesting that in Fred Holland's article in about Larkin that I think was around, I can't remember which year it was, in 2006, something like that, it goes back, he did say there that he felt there was more, he quoting him, more recent unpublished information suggested that Larkin was being disingenuous. Larkin had looked through the papers and said he couldn't find anything that suggested his father related to the link. But what Fred doesn't do is to say what that evidence is, and there isn't any that I've come across that would tie this down. But even if he had, Sydney had been on the edges or around the edges of that kind of activity, I thought the play was interesting because it might be something that people would follow up. If he was known to be someone who had those sympathies at one level at any time, then these are the kind of organisations that will come up and bite you.
And also there must have been the espionage going on between Germany and other European countries in those days. I mean, it's not a leap to imagine that regardless of the circumstances or the reasons that Sidney visited Germany, given his position, he would have been approached by all sorts of people for information going either way, really. It's a shame I suppose my hope is that some of the papers in the archive that have been embargoed, I can't remember until when, my hope is that some of those might actually answer some of these questions.
Well, the ones I think you're probably referring to that were embargoed, was the key one was Sidney Larkin's war diaries, which I think he labelled the Fool's War at one point. They were embargoed for a very long time. They're out. They've been out for a few years now. In fact, James Booth refers to them in his biography. There's nothing in those diaries which go right through the war. There's nothing in there that gives any indication of a sympathy for a Nazi cause. There is a lot in there which shows that Sidney Larkin didn't like Churchill. And I'm not sure he would be the only one that didn't like church for various reasons at the time. But there's nothing in it that is you know, giving any indication above and beyond the fact that he thought possibly the war, maybe there was argument for not the war, we're not getting involved in the war at some point. But there's nothing in the diary that suggests anything around, you know, the extremities of that.
And what are the other papers that are still embargoed?
Well, I don't know, actually. No. I mean, apart from we know there are letters to Bruce Montgomery, but that's in a different context. But
right.
I'm not sure there's anything else that's still embargoed that relates to the war period.
Right.
As far as I'm aware, anyway. Yeah. There is something, I came across something in the letters, a letter that Sidney Larkin wrote to Philip Larkin in 1944 as the war was coming to an end, really, or sort of last stages. And he's talking about, he says in the letter, "My diary takes a lot of bringing up to date." This was in April 1944. And then he goes on, "I think the attempted assassination of Hitler must indicate a serious split in the German ranks. The great destruction of their towns must, I think, bring the war to a fairly quick end. I hope so."
Mm.
Well, you could read that in a number of different ways, but there's an indication of something he said during the war. And after the war, there's an indication in another letter that the British Commission in Germany might have contacted him at some point to help them with the post-war reconstruction. It's quite a frightening thought.
It really is.
Yeah.
I liked the inclusion of the poems. Was that in the original?
No.
Play? So you
the original, all the poems were added in, all the historical context was added in, the mention of Brunette Coleman was added in, and the mention of the mass funerals, or at least the quote from the bishop, was added in. And after, when Philip finishes the play by saying, "They fuck you up, your mum and dad," the bit after that is also added in. And I decided to do that just in order to provide context so that people could listen to the play and learn a bit about the history of Coventry and the school, as well as finding out about the Larkin family.
That's great. And it was nice to hear, you know, Ultimatum being read. It's a really nice early poem with some interesting imagery on there. I like that final stanza about, you know, remember the stories you read when a boy, you know, for now you must escape. Just a kind of poem on growing up, isn't it?
Or perish if you say no. I think that's a really interesting poem because it was written and published just as he left Coventry and moved to Oxford. And it really does. I have to say, I didn't really like James Booth's comments on it. I think that must have been in his biography. To me, it just screams the sort of claustrophobia of adolescence and needing to get out, but also the fact that the war has started and is closing in and England's not a great place to be. I just think on so many levels it talks about his circumstances at that time.
Yeah, I agree. It was lovely to have. I really like it when people come to the podcast with a poem that, you know, is not well known.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Particularly the very early ones, because they're always something you learn from reading them, especially when you can put them into the context like you can with Ultimatum. Thank you for doing that. I thought that was a great idea. And of course, the other two, April Sunday Brings the Snow, just breaks my heart every time I hear that poem.
Yeah.
How you can write a poem about jam and make it so... so moving and so beautiful. Mm-hmm. And that metaphor, the jam being made by somebody's hands that since has passed away.
It's interesting, isn't it, really, in a sense, because it reflects something of a complicated set of feelings that Larkin seemed to have about both his parents, actually.
Yeah.
And in this sense, you know, with Sidney, there's, you know, it is what we know from the letters and elsewhere is that Sidney's death really, really knocked him, and he struggled with, and clearly his mother struggled with it as well. I was reading again bits of Andrew Motion's biography yesterday around the relationship between Sidney and Eva, and where Motion claims that, I don't know where he got this from necessarily, but that by the time that Philip Larkin was born, his parents had fallen out of love. Well, if they did, when Sidney died, Eva seemed to fall back in love, because all the way through the letters, there's some very, very kind of positive and sad reflections on aspects of that, or happy memories of things that they experienced.
Was that kind of based on the fact that they weren't physically demonstrative? What was his evidence for them having fallen out of love?
Evidence, but I mean, you know, my own conjecture on some of this is that there's a 10-year gap between Kitty and Philip. And I think from what Eva said as well, when he was born, it shifted things quite a lot for her, you know, in terms of her experiences and her role. And, it does with many relationships, you know, it was a burden on her to some degree from what she said. So it could be to do with, this whole, kind of dynamics of family life.
Yeah, really interesting.
I do want to give a lot of credit to Sheila Woolf.
Yeah.
Who does the, she doesn't introduce herself, but she does the initial introduction and sets the play within the context of the school's history and the former pupils involved with Fred Holland, the play's author. Yeah. She also has really fought quite a long and lonely battle to promote Larkin within the school. Mm-hmm. And if it wasn't for her, I wouldn't know about the play and the context and all of that sort of thing. So she really does deserve a lot of credit as far as Philip Larkin Society is concerned.
In 2002, King Henry VIII's school library celebrated its quattercentenary. In its early days, it had held an extraordinary and valuable collection, with volumes given by the great and the good, including eminent visitors such as Princess Elizabeth and her father, King James I. Sadly, most of the library's books had disappeared by 2002, either sold or destroyed in the blitzes on Coventry. It seemed appropriate then to seize the opportunity to include in our celebrations a lasting memorial to our most famous former librarian, Philip Larkin, who'd been a sixth form librarian at the school before going on, obviously, to make a distinguished career in librarianship. We found a space, admittedly not a particularly beautiful space, but this was to become the Philip Larkin Room, overlooking the quadrangle, and at its entrance was placed a brass commemorative plaque, a portrait of Larkin, and framed poems. We chose New Eyes Each Year and The Trees. The room itself was formally opened on Saturday, May the 10th, with a small reception and speeches given by old Coventrians who'd gone up to Oxford some 10 years after Larkin. We had begun our celebrations, however, on May the 9th, when we held a Philip Larkin evening. The first half comprised a selection of readings called Unexpected Larkin, chosen by my predecessor as Head of English, Tony Burrows, and read by local actors Amy Haynes and Rex Satchwell. After a short interval, a rehearsed reading of the play The Larkin Family by Fred Holland took place, produced by me and acted by 5 sixth form theatre studies students. It was fitting that both Tony Burrows and Fred Holland were asked to create the substance of the evening. They were at Oxford, Tony at St John's, Fred at Hartford, in the early 1950s, and both were devotees of Larkin. As schoolboys, they had attended Henry's and therefore naturally felt a particular interest in Larkin's formative years. There are other close connections. Larkin's famous essay, Not the Place's Fault, reflecting on I Remember, I Remember, was published in Umbrella magazine, the journal of Coventry's Umbrella Club, founded in 1955. Its constitution declared that it existed to encourage interest in art, music, literature, the theatre and kindred subjects. The magazine was first published in 1958, Fred Holland being the inaugural editor. That first edition contained submissions by E. M. Forster, George Macbeth and Tony Burrows, among others. Fred took inspiration from the Larkin family background, setting his short play, it lasted only 20 minutes, on April the 20th, 1941, Hitler's birthday. Only 10 days before this date, the school had been almost entirely destroyed by incendiary bombs. It was, of course, only a few months after Larkin went up to St John's in 1940 that the Coventry Blitz had occurred, obliterating much of the city with which Larkin was familiar. At the same time, his father had presciently ordered 1,000 cardboard coffins, anticipating the likely outcome of German raids on the city. The production took place, fittingly enough, in the school library. Several of Fred's contemporaries or near contemporaries attended, men with whom he'd been friends all his life. The audience was, in other respects, largely made up of friends of the school, staff, Larkin enthusiasts and, pleasingly, students. Despite the performance being a rehearsed reading rather than its being acted, and this was at Fred's request, sympathising with the fact that the cast were within weeks of their A-levels, the tension of the storyline kept the audience in its spell. The fictional Nazi sympathiser Roger Smythe, played by Roddy Peters, now a Bristol Old Vic-trained actor, gave a truly sinister glimpse into British fascist organisations. Father and son Larkin were truthfully imagined. Eva Larkin was portrayed just as one might imagine, nervy, over-talkative and eager to please. Fred had woven four real characters and one fictional invention in such a way that everyone felt at the close of the performance that the events could really have taken place. Following that long weekend in 2002, Fred wrote articles for About Larkin and continued to be a celebrated local poet and literary critic. Tony organised many public readings of Larkin's poems in a variety of Coventry venues. The lifelong friends died 2 years apart, Fred in 2009 and Tony in 2007. They had long outlived Larkin, but they had spent many years ensuring a lasting appreciation of both the man and his poetry. The library's quatercentenary activities had been a small but memorable contribution to the school's continuing celebration of Philip Larkin.
Ultimatum by Philip Larkin. But we must build our walls, for what we are necessitates it, and we must construct the ship to navigate behind them, there. Hopeless to ignore, helpless instruct. For any term of time beyond the years that warn us of the need for emigration, exploded the ancient saying, life is yours. For on our island is no railway station. There are no tickets for the Vale of Peace, no docks where trading ships and seagulls pass. Remember stories you read when a boy, the shipwrecked sailor gaining safety by his knife, tree trunk and lianas. For now, you must escape or perish saying no.
Having previously only published his writing in his school magazine, the Coventrian, Philip Larkin, received 2 guineas for the publication of his sonnet, Ultimatum, in the Weekly Listener magazine in November 1940. He had written it around the time he left King Henry VIII School to take up his place at St John's College, Oxford. described as an Ordenesque sonnet with self-consciously obscure imagery by James Booth. The poem's title and its political, highly moral tone reflect Larkin's preoccupation with the start of the war and his gloomy view of humanity compared with nature. It describes crushing claustrophobia and a burning desire to escape to a desert island. It's now Sunday, 17th of November 1940. 3 days earlier, the Luftwaffe swarmed the sky and made their boldest attempt to flatten Coventry. Larkin has hitchhiked his way home to check on his family, but has found the house empty. Upon returning to Oxford, he receives a telegram from his father.
"I'm quite safe, Daddy."
I wonder why Sidney ghosted his son for 3 days.
November 1940, St John's College, Oxford. "Dear Fembley, this letter is addressed primarily to Pop, but I don't know where he will be when this is due to be delivered. First, I was tremendously relieved to know that you were safe. Well, you had the bombing, fires, rescue parties and all the rest of the grim trappings of air raids. We up here merely had the unpleasant rumours, the horrific newspaper, and the lack of news. We heard of a raid at lunchtime on Friday. We immediately sent telegrams off to Coventry, but this was patently futile. By Saturday dinner time I hadn't any news, so I sent another telegram. Hughes and I decided to go to Coventry if no news awaited us on Sunday morning. It didn't. Remarks to Mop. No Marmite yet. We subsist on weird and peculiar pots of fish paste. Very much love to both. Philip."
The next big air raid is on the 8th of April 1941, and this time, at home for his Easter holidays, Philip is there to witness it firsthand.
"And I write to my sister in Leicester the very next day to let her know we're all safe. 9th of April 1941, Penvorn, Manor Road, Coventry. Dear Catherine, subsequent to my first air raid with real live bomb last night, I am sound in mind and body. So is Pop, and Mop, who is here as well. But the general opinion prevailing at present is that you shouldn't return as you had intended. As regards the raid, an attack appeared to be directed at the station, and the Goodyards was burnt. So was the grammar school. Bombs fell. Anyway, it wasn't very pleasant. Philip. P.S. It's not meant to be."
The first of the mass burials following the Easter air raids is on Easter Tuesday, and the Coventry Standard reported on the 26th of April 1941 that the Bishop of Coventry said that this country is not yet under the heel of Hitler, and please God, it is never going to be. But first, they know there is only one way by which this freedom is going to be preserved. There is only one way open out of the ruin by which they are surrounded, and that this is the path of continued struggle and effort, and sweat and toil and sacrifice and suffering, and last, and by no means least, in prayer. There is no escape from that, and they must take their sorrow and let it become a spring of fresh energy. Coventry is not alone in suffering like this. And so now, 5 days later, and knowing the background to this story, we're joining the Larkin family during the late afternoon of the 20th of April 1941. Ava is shown an unexpected visitor into the formal drawing room of the Larkin family home, Penvorn, in Manor Road, Coventry, now raised from history under the concrete mass of the brutalist Ring Road. This be the play.
Thing.
"I'm sorry, would you like to keep your coat and scarf on? It's not very warm in here. We haven't got much coal and that window was blown out in the last raid. There was a bomb fell in one of the gardens just over the road. Excuse me."
"Philip, can you turn that down, please? Your father's got a visitor."
"If you don't mind waiting here. He's at the council house, even though it's Sunday. The raids create a lot of extra work. He shouldn't be long, although I'm never sure. He always likes his meals on time. You say you met him before the war?"
"Yes."
Father's got a visitor, and I've got a headache. Why don't you come down and talk to him? I'm sure he'd be pleased to meet you. He's on holiday from Oxford. Oh, I mustn't say that, must I? It's vacation. He's due for his medical soon, and then I guess he'll be called up. His old school was burnt down in the last raid. After the all clear, we watched it from the bedroom window. He's only doing it to be awkward. My black-haired boy. When I'm trying to stop him stuttering, that's what I get him to say, you know? Black-haired boy. And he shouts, without stuttering, would you believe it? I'd rather be a beautiful brunette. And I say, don't be silly, dear. You're a boy with black hair, not a girl with brown hair.
As the day wanes, late autumn cold seeps into the room. Beyond the undertones of tension resonating around this room, Philip has a conflict of their own.
Brunette is my female alter ego. She liberates my creativity and allows me to explore my self in ways that I can never do as Philip. It is, after all, the love that dare not speak its name. Although I tried once, when this face was younger, one man and I heaped love on each other till love ran dry. Would I be more free as a girl?
Back to Ava and her visitor.
Mind you, I don't call it music at all.
Neither do I.
Oh, don't you?
Degenerate.
What?
That music, it's degenerate.
Would you like a cup of tea? If you don't mind powdered milk. They say it's the same, but I don't think so. His father won't have it at all. I don't think they realise what I've got to do since we lost our maid. She was called up, you know. The one before that got pregnant, so we had to get rid of her right away. We've advertised. My husband interviewed two girls. They were the only ones who applied, but he said neither was suitable. But you can't be choosy, not in wartime, can you?
No.
Are you sure you won't take your coat off?
No, thank you.
Would you like me to get you a cup of tea?
No, it's very kind of you.
You say you met my husband before the war?
Yes.
Are you a treasurer?
No.
Oh, I thought you might be a borough treasurer somewhere.
No.
He goes to a lot of places without me, on business, of course. Although he did take me on holiday to Germany just before the war started. 1938 it was. He'd already taken Philip to Germany in 1936 and 1937, but Philip didn't like it much. Mr. Larkin brought me this lovely souvenir from Nuremberg, I think.
Yes, I know.
Of course, being city treasurer, he's very busy. He's got to go to London tomorrow, but he doesn't tell me much. Not that I'd understand anyway. Did you know he got the OBE in the New Year's Honours List? But he didn't tell me about it, not before it was announced. That's how I heard about it, over the wireless. Now, I wonder who that can be. It's the coal man, I hope, or the dustman. It's 3 weeks since our dustbins were emptied. Oh dear, silly me. You don't get the coal man or dustman on a Sunday, do you? Excuse me. I better just go and see who it is. Fancy having two visitors at once, and on a Sunday of all days.
I'm sorry to disturb you, but I've just got to get Mr. Larkin to sign these papers.
Well, you better come in, Captain. I was just saying to this gentleman, it's not very warm in here, is it?
Oh, I'm sorry to disturb you.
No, you're not disturbing us. This gentleman knew my husband before the war. Isn't that right?
Yes.
I'm sorry to disturb you on a Sunday, but I've just got to get Mr. Larkin to sign these papers. I telephoned his office, but they'd say he just left and was on his way home. Only I know he's going to London tomorrow, and I've got to get them signed in time for tomorrow's meeting of the police committee. Otherwise, we won't be able to pay anybody. It won't take a moment.
I should introduce you. This is Captain Hector, the Chief Constable of Coventry, and you are...
Smythe.
Mr. Smythe.
How do you do?
Pleased to meet you.
Well, if he's on his way home, he should be here in a minute, unless he has to make a detour. I believe there's a delayed action bomb in St. Patrick's Road.
Yes, there is.
You know, I thought you were the dustman, although I was really hoping you were the coalman. And then I thought, don't be silly, Eva, not on a Sunday.
I'm sorry to disappoint you.
Can I leave you two to talk together? I've got so much to do, finding something for us to eat. My husband and Philip don't realise. I was queuing yesterday for dried fruit. I shall be glad when this war's over. Do you mind?
No, not at all. So you knew Mr. Larkin before the war?
Yes.
You don't sound like you're from Coventry, but do you live here?
No.
Do you know Larkin's son?
No, but from what I hear of his taste in so-called music.
A bit of a flamboyant dresser. Why, even before he went to Oxford, I saw him in town wearing a green jacket, a red tie, and yellow gloves. Oh, wow, he'll soon be in uniform. that'll make a difference. He's just having a good time at the moment, studying in Oxford. I began my police career in Oxford before the last war. You should see what some of them undergraduates got up to even then. Smashing windows and then going round with their checkbook the following morning. Mind you, they could afford it. But a good many of them were killed. I served all through the Great War, so I saw it.
Did you?
Yes, not many men of your age are out of uniform these days. Are you in a reserved occupation?
Yes, but I'm not allowed to talk about it.
Quite right too. Careless talk costs lives, as they say. It's only 2 years since we fined a man 10 shillings for wearing a Nazi uniform.
Oh, really?
Yes. Although, of course, if he tried it these days, after these air raids, people would string him up. There's another mass funeral on Thursday. It's a good job Mr. Larkin ordered all those coffins. That's foresight for you. He ordered 1,000 cardboard coffins when war broke out. Good job. The undertakers would never have managed. They've nearly all gone. Saved the city quite a lot of money, that did. Oh, good. I think that's Mr. Larkin.
They're in here.
Hello?
I'm sorry to trouble you, Mr. Larkin, but I wonder if you would sign these estimates we agreed yesterday. I tried to catch you before you left your office.
What the?
This should cover overtime and special duties for next month.
What's the matter?
Nothing.
This is Mr. Smythe.
If you could just sign here. And here. That's not like you, Mr. Larkin. You usually scrutinise every word. I might have doubled my income, for all you know.
I doubt it.
Well, that's fine. Thank you very much. Sorry to have delayed you. I'd better be on my way.
Won't you have a cup of tea before you go?
No. Thank you, Mrs. Larkin. Very kind. Mr. Larkin, you'll be going to the funeral next week. I hope it's the last of these tragic mass burials. Although, I did tell Mr. Smythe about your impressive foresight in ordering all those coffins at the outbreak of war.
Indeed. I'll see you there, no doubt.
Nice to have met you, Mr. Smythe. Goodbye.
Goodbye, Chief Constable.
I'll see you out.
What do you want?
What?
I said, what do you want?
I've come to congratulate you on your OBE.
I thought you were locked up in Brixton Prison.
I was. I've been released on health grounds. They've given me 6 months to live and don't regard a dying man as a threat. More fool them. A dying man's got nothing to lose, has he? I've brought a message for you from Sir Barry Domville. You knew he was interned as well?
Yes.
And Oswald Mosley. All good patriots. If they'd listened to us, Coventry would still be standing. Hitler didn't want this war, not with us. He had the greatest respect for England.
I'm well aware of that.
It's that traitor, Churchill, who's the warmonger. Hitler's interests in Europe are legitimate interests. Why should we go to war for Poland? It was the Jews that forced us into it. Domville and Mosley are sick men. The conditions in Brixton Prison are terrible. Domville knows all about you and your sympathies. You can help us.
What?
Schacht said you were the best municipal treasurer in England. Why are you hiding away in this godforsaken city?
Circumstances?
Circumstances? Sir Oswald and the Führer would say we must be masters of our own circumstances and not slaves to them. You met her, Schacht?
We corresponded.
Did you not meet when you visited Germany?
We might have done.
You admired him?
He alone rescued Germany from economic collapse.
I believe Keynes admired him.
Everyone admired him.
Now, what we would like you to do is this. As you know, certain money was made available from German sources to support the work of the Link.
So I believe.
But the work of the Link is not finished. Just because that traitor Churchill has banned the organisation and locked us up. It is still essential to maintain these links with the fatherland so that when the time comes and this country sues for peace, there is an organisation there, in place, ready to take over.
I'm sorry, I cannot take part in any activity which would jeopardise my position. Or my family.
I notice you still have a souvenir from Nuremberg.
It's not illegal.
But do they know, these people who gave you the OBE, where your sympathies lie?
My sympathies are my own affair.
You once had more courage than that. I'm told you still had a model of Herr Hitler on your desk when war broke out.
And who told you that?
Gossip. Anyway, I have it on good authority that the German government is still prepared to make the funds available to further the work of reconciliation, in spite of hostilities. There are bank accounts in Switzerland and Ireland which can be made available. You have the expertise, the knowledge, the contacts, the unimpeachable reputation to arrange this.
Impossible.
Not at all. Thanks to the raid last November, Coventry is now an international symbol, and as such, it will be the easiest thing in the world to set up a fund, internationally based, for post-war reconstruction, with you as its treasurer. No one could trace its sources, and no one could trace all its expenditure. If only 50,000 were made available to our sympathizers, it would make all the difference. In different currencies, in different banks, it would be easy.
It might be possible. It would not be easy.
There you are, then. You are our man.
I am not your man.
You agree that this country has embarked upon a disastrous war which should never have happened? You admire German efficiency, German methods. If this war goes on much longer, where will we be? Our cities in ruins, our empire sold off, broken, impoverished, a communist government in power? Last year, honourable members of the government made peace feelers through the Swedish ambassador, which were well received in Berlin. Then Churchill found out and our hopes were dashed. The Führer respects true Englishmen. The real menace lies in the East, as it always has done.
I must ask you to moderate your voice, if not your sentiments.
Why? There's only your unwitting, or should I say witless, Hausfrau, and according to your other visitor, your flamboyant son, who plays degenerate music. Oh yes, I have heard it. I will show you what true nerve is.
For God's sake, man, what on earth are you wearing that for?
I am wearing this uniform to show my pride in the fatherland and to mark...
Are you mad? Do you know who that was in here a moment ago?
Yes, the Chief Constable of Coventry. I laugh at the police. And I ask you, do you know what day it is today?
April the...
Yes, April the 20th, the Führer's birthday. When you and I saw him on that rostrum in 1937, did we not cheer together?
Put your coat on, man, for goodness sake. You know you can get 10 years for that.
Mr. Larkin, Coventry City Treasurer, OBE. I don't have 10 years left.
Well, I do, I hope. And I don't want to spend them behind bars. Put your coat on now.
There. Are you happy? Do you not think great causes demand great courage? Your police chief talked about uniforms. I laughed at him. Now, will you work for us? Will you seize this moment in history, which may not come again? You go to London tomorrow. I can arrange for you to meet someone in the government who can be relied upon.
No.
No? I ask you for the last time, for England and for the fatherland.
Yes?
Mother?
Come in. This is my son, Philip.
How do you do?
Your mother tells me you are going into the army. Do they teach you how to fight at Oxford, or only to drink and play degenerate music? Have you not heard Wagner? That is proper character-building music. Will you make a good soldier? Are you ready to die for your country?
No.
No doubt you will die, though. You will join those others in Flanders fields, or maybe nearer to home. Your mother will be proud of you, and your father too. What do you Latin scholars say? Dulce et decorum et pro patria mori. And if you live, what will you be?
I think you'd like to be a poet.
A poet? Another Heine, another Goethe, composing patriotic songs for great occasions? You will be the poet of England, summing up the nation's mood when England is great again. A Rupert Brooke, perhaps. If I should die, think only this of me, that there's a corner of a foreign field that is forever England. Yes?
No.
Ah, but the army will make a man of you to suffer in battle. You will despise those lily-livered cowards who skulk at home. Not for you, the bookish world, with furtive flirtation behind the library stacks. How I envy you, but I have had my chance. Mr. Larkin, I hope you will think about what I have said and reconsider. Then you will be proud of each other. The son a great commander. The father, well, he could be the father of history. The father of two nations.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but would you like to stay, Mr. Smythe, for some tea? I've got a herring this morning, and we've got some bread and margarine, and Mrs. Bramwell has given me a little pot of plum jam she made. It's very nice. We had some last year, didn't we, Sydney?
No, I'm afraid Mr. Smythe won't be staying.
No, I must go. But it's very kind of you. I was just telling your son what a fine career he might have in the army.
Oh, I think he wants to write, don't you, dear?
Caesar wrote. Mr. Larkin, we must meet again.
No.
No.
No, it is not possible.
It is very easy.
No.
You might regret it.
Perhaps.
Very well. You will disappoint some brave man. I'm pleased to have met you, Philip. I hope you inherit courage from somewhere. Goodbye, Mrs. Larkin. Enjoy your English herring.
I think it's Scottish. I'm not sure.
Whatever it is, give your husband the backbone. Goodbye, Mr. Sidney Larkin, OBE. I shall not see the end of this war, but perhaps you will, and perhaps you will think about what I have said. Goodbye, Philip, poet of England.
I'm sorry you can't stay.
They fuck you up, your mum and dad. This be the verse by Philip Larkin. They fuck you up, your mum and dad. They may not mean to, but they do. They fill you with the faults they had and add some extra, just for you. But they were fucked up in their turn by fools in old-style hats and coats who half the time were soppy stern and half at one another's throats. Man hands on misery to man. It deepens like a coastal shelf. Get out as early as you can. And don't have any kids yourself.
On 1st January 1942, Philip received a letter by special delivery telling him that he has failed his army medical and that he will not be called up. Unfortunately, so convinced had he been that he would be found to be perfectly capable of sweeping a naffy floor or something like that, he had already sold his books and burnt all his lecture notes.
The Link, discussed by Sidney and Roger, was a Nazi organization founded by Sir Barry Domville in June 1937, before being closed at the commencement of war. Its founder was interned for the war's duration. Sidney was a rumored member, a branch existing in Birmingham. Philip's biographer, Andrew Motion, quotes a former colleague of his at Hull. According to Philip, Sidney had been an ardent follower of the Nazis and attended several Nuremberg rallies during the 1930s. He even had a statue of Hitler on the mantelpiece, which, at the touch of a button, gave a Nazi salute. A colleague of Sidney's is also reported as reluctantly confirming that, as late as 1939, Sidney had Nazi regalia decorating his office in City Hall, and when war was declared, he was ordered by the town clerk to remove it.
Sidney will die on Good Friday, 1948, almost exactly 7 years later, at the age of 63. Shortly after his father's funeral, Philip will write his elegy for him.
Snow in April, by Philip Larkin. An April Sunday brings the snow, making the blossom on the plum trees green, not white. An hour or two, and it will go. Strange that I spend that hour moving between cupboard and cupboard, shifting the store of jam you made of fruit from these same trees. 5 loads, 100 pounds or more than enough for all next summer's teas. Wish now you will not sit and eat, behind the glass, underneath the cellophane, remains your final summer, sweet and meaningless, and not to come again.
Much later, when John Betjeman dies in 1984, Philip will be invited to be the poet of England, summing up the nation's mood, but will decline the offer because his output of poems has all but dried up. Philip will die from esophageal cancer the following year at the age of 63, as he had long predicted he would, and nearly 20 years after his death, he will be named the nation's favorite poet, and in 2016, a plaque in his memory will be laid in Westminster Abbey's Poets' Corner.
Fresh fish, fresh fish, fresh fish. Some of them.
Eva Larkin, played by Clemmy Andrews.
Narrator number one, played by Simran Chima.
Captain Stanley Hector, played by Aston McEwen.
Sydney Larkin, played by Ocean.
Narrator number two, played by Leanne L.
Roger Smythe, played by Adam Price.
Philip Larkin, played by Ben Cartwright.
Don't have oysters, clams, but do I want a seafood dish?
Thank you so much to Helen and all the students and staff at King Henry VIII School, Coventry, who put so much time and energy into this production. We are holding our AGM at the school this year, and I'm really excited to visit it for the first time. I wanted to say hello to Anne Gibson and Sally Hawkes, who were two of our guests in Hull at the Fantastic Alliance of Literary Societies AGM recently, and are very loyal listeners and Philip Larkin Society members. Our centenary celebrations and events are gathering pace, so please keep an eye on the PLS website, Twitter, Instagram, and support us in any way you can. And if you're not already a member of the Philip Larkin Society, why not join? This podcast was produced by Simon Galloway, and the opening music is The Horns of the Morning by The Mechanicals Band. And as ever, if you have any comments or any suggestions, I love hearing from you, so please get in touch.
The horns of the morning are blowing, are shining. The meadow is wet with the coldest of dew. The dawn reassembles.